This is Life Center Around the Table with your host, Paul Martini.
Welcome to Around the Table podcast. I'm your host, Paul Martini, here at Life Center, and I have the incredible opportunity of being with some of these amazing worship leaders, people of God who love Jesus, and Bethany and Caleb from, actually, you guys are living in Hanover, Pennsylvania, is that right? Mm-hmm. Not too far from us. Apparently, that city is a little bit windier, less windier.
Less windier.
He told me, than Harrisburg, which is pretty incredible. But man, I'm so glad to have you guys on the podcast here. Thanks for coming on.
Yeah, thanks for having us.
Yes,
absolutely honored to be here. So
yeah, so you guys have been doing music your whole life, or is this just like a new thing for you?
Definitely a long time. I remember singing since the second grade and doing, you know, chapels and things like that. So yeah, it's been a while.
Yeah, my family is super musical. My mom is like the music director at her church, and my dad's played guitar for as long as I've ever known. So, Yeah, we've just all grown up playing music, singing. And then I started writing music in high school, got my first guitar, and just kind of haven't looked back since then.
That's amazing. Mm-hmm. But you also look like a very mountain man. So, yeah. I mean, like John Aiken, like out of West Virginia or something.
Right,
like,
right.
You have that kind of like background, or are you a PA boy?
I grew up in Virginia Beach, Virginia. So I always loved camping, but definitely love the ocean, and I would charge hard on some hurricane storms and stuff like that and go out and huge surf and stuff. So I'm all outdoors, but also music and sports and kind of a weird hodgepodge of all of it.
Yeah, that's so cool.
Mm-hmm.
So, and then now, Bethany, you're from North Carolina, you had said, so you're not even used to this kind of area. When did you move up here?
We moved up here. We've almost been here for 2 years.
Whoa.
So yeah, definite transition from
still
the
fresh.
South.
Yeah.
Culture shock a little bit, but it's been good.
Really? What do you think is one of the big culture differences in this area? I mean, I have my own thoughts.
Right.
But what do you guys think compared to...
Are you from PA?
Well, you know, that's a great question because...
I want to be careful what I say.
Yeah, you can say whatever you want. Just nothing about the Philadelphia Eagles. No, I'm just kidding.
Okay.
No, I'm from outside Philadelphia. I was born in Philly, lived there most of my life. I moved here 10 years ago.
Nice.
Wow.
Okay. And my wife and I have been living... Well, she moved over about 7 years ago.
Awesome.
That's so awesome. We've been married for, maybe she moved over here 8 years ago. We've been married for almost 7 years.
Wow. Oh, congratulations.
Yeah. That's amazing. Yeah. I think the biggest culture shock would be like the South is very religious. So everybody goes to church.
In a good way.
In a good way.
Uh-huh.
Kind of.
Sometimes.
I didn't know what you meant by it. So.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Depends.
Well, the South is very churched. We'll just say
a lot of Muslims. Is that what you're saying? There's a lot of religious Muslims down there.
There actually are. But
there really are. Right. Tons of Christians there.
Yes.
They're used to the Christian lifestyle, living behavior,
so,
which is great. But
Up here, I feel like people are super hungry.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like when I mention like Sunday school classics, they're like, wait, who's Jonah? What?
Right.
And you're like, wow. Like, you know, that's not really a thing. Like everyone has grown up in Sunday school in the South, it feels like.
Right.
And they at least know a lot about the Bible. And here there's just such a hunger to know more about Jesus and learn like crazy. So that's been really refreshing just to have that opportunity to conversate like that.
Yeah, in the South too, because they're so church, it kind of comes across as like, oh, yeah, that's expected to be known. Even if I don't know, I'll never say I don't know. Whereas here it's been refreshing that there's been like, oh, I've never heard of that before.
Yeah.
But at the same time, there's also like Southern's very hospitable, very nice. Hey, how are you doing? I'll talk to you for 3 hours at the gas station. Here it's like, don't talk to me. And so like there's a hunger, but you have to like fight to get in.
Mm-hmm.
Down South, you can get in, but then to be able to bring something that they haven't heard before is like, you know, kind of shakes them. And so there's like that battle. So it's been a complete culture shock for us to go from deep South to the North, but we've enjoyed it.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, it definitely is different. And I think it's in pockets, like honestly, like a lot of places here, you know, they have that Mennonite kind of like background.
Yes.
So they are very churched and they're like Lancaster County, tons of, you know, people who've been to church their whole life, been to Sunday school.
Right.
So, I mean, but then if you go to a pocket, like maybe some places in the counties that you are in, you know, they're not as much, you know, used to that, like
yeah,
all those you know, Old Testament stories that mm-hmm. they would have gotten in the, yes. if they haven't done their reading in right. Sunday school.
Right.
So, you know, unfortunately.
Maybe it's more to do with just the lack of reading. Yeah.
I mean, I wasn't going to say it, but.
But you got it.
But most Christians don't read their Bibles.
They don't.
Right. Crazy.
They don't.
Yes.
And so then you reference something, they go, where is that? And I'm like, it's here. And they're like, oh, I've never read that before. But then there's
an
excitement.
In the South, that's unheard of.
Right.
It's like, yeah. you better know it by the back of your hand.
Right. Bible drill.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
All the things.
That's really interesting.
Yeah.
Mm. And then there's, of course, you know, the relationships in the central PA area go back so far, right. generations.
Right.
You know, so it could be like, you know, the kids just friends, but the parents have been friends for a generation, and the
yes.
parents, and they, everyone knows each other kind of thing.
Oh yeah.
Right.
And so like you come in and you're like, everyone's really friendly, but mm-hmm. your relationship with them doesn't compare to the relationships
right.
they have,
because
right. you can't replace people's history
right.
with other
right.
people.
Right.
And they're brilliant, but everyone's super nice here.
Right.
And I love it. We're not hating on you guys.
Right. Now we noticed right. that too, like Mississippi was kind of the same. Like there's such deep family ties there. And a lot of people who are family that grew up there, like they stay there. Whereas, right. and so like to be in that culture, you know, you really couldn't break in. And same thing here, but we go to Providence Community Church and people there just brought us in. And so like, wow. we were like, okay, we're moving. Had to start over. It's going to be slow, but people brought us in immediately.
Yeah. Wow.
And so like that community, I think if you don't have like a church you're moving into and you don't have those relationships already built, I can understand that moving would be a lot harder, but this last move is way easier for us than we thought.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And that, you know, when God calls you somewhere, it doesn't mean it's going to be easy,
right.
but there is a grace
right.
you find on yourself right, that you're right, like, right. okay, I know this is the Lord because even in the midst of all the craziness, this feels easy or good or, mm-hmm. you know, yes. whatever. And you have this like steadfastness maybe mm-hmm. more or less about it. But that's so great, man. So how are you guys, so you've supported local churches in the atmosphere, the sphere of worship.
Mm-hmm.
And so what is that like, or what do you guys feel you're called to in terms of cultivating a worship atmosphere or lifestyle or band, or and either yeah. of you can speak into that.
Yeah. Well, I definitely think it's been so amazing to get to lead at so many different places and
yeah.
cultures. And, you know, I've been in places where it's like raising your hands is weird. Or mm-hmm. Then I've been in cultures where you know, like spontaneous is weird.
Yeah.
And let's just keep that off the mic, you know,
right.
just put the mic down when you do that. And I've learned to respect all of those cultures and
yeah. That's good.
Wait for the go ahead. Mm-hmm. And that has been really hard. It felt like a cage for so long, but I found such freedom in being able to worship the Lord, even in those boundaries that are the boxes that I've been put in. And then it's been really refreshing, you know, after year, seeing the progression
yeah.
and the allowance of people who, you know, I used to hold the mic down when I was doing spontaneous moments. And I remember the first time the worship pastor looking at me and saying, pick up the mic and sing it out.
Wow.
And yeah. The Holy Spirit fell, and then prophetic words were being shared, and it was insane. And then just moving further and further in that to where now I feel like I'm in this place and at a church where they champion that
right.
and there's space to be able to go there. And so in the past, like I remember when I first began, it was about getting crowd participation. And mm-hmm. And then you have that frustration when there's not. And now I've learned that it's less about getting them to be where I'm at and more so like he's the focus. So if I make my focus on you, I'm going to be super frustrated by the end of this because right. it looks like you're
That's
just
good.
Statues.
Just a yeah. wall of people just saying,
right.
what
like,
you got?
And yeah. so now it's like totally upward focus to where my concern is like just looking at Jesus and enjoying him.
Mm-hmm.
And when I'm in that space, then yeah. I open my eyes and I look around and then I get to see that people are joining me or they're like, whoa. Sometimes the statues aren't just judgment. It's like, mm-hmm. I've never seen that before.
Right.
And
right.
they're wondering and they're watching. And it's just been beautiful to see that progression of like letting go mm-hmm. and just entering in and then mm-hmm. having them follow.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I think that's awesome. You know, my son is a real deep thinker and he forgets to tell his face that he's a deep thinker. like we'll be sitting on the front row and he's 16 years old and he'll be like just staring.
Locked
and,
in.
Yeah. Just,
yes.
And I'm like, bro, I was like, bro, are you okay? He's like, yeah, why? I'm like, are you happy? He's like, yeah. I said, tell your face because everyone thinks you're miserable. Like, I don't want you to be fake. The like, if you're not is- happy, then don't be happy. But if you're happy, let someone know.
Right.
But
because the worship leader is so like disappointed right now, thinking they're not doing anything. Right.
I know because I, you know, I teach sometimes at church and preach sometimes. Yeah. It's like the people who are smiling, you're like, they're sucking in. And then you like, look at the guy who's like, and you're like, right. And then all your faith is gone. You start sweating. You're like, where's that person who was smiling? Right. Get him back. You know, like that's so when but you know, my son, like people like my son, because you know, there's many people who are just such deep thinkers
that
they're really experiencing the Lord.
Absolutely.
And they just are forgetting to tell anyone else, which is fine.
Right.
But and then I've seen him even in this past firestorm, which was like phenomenal, you know, like him opening up and just worshiping. And I was like, wow, that is so cool because that's big for him. He was like, there was a journey he was going on, like from, you know, meditating on what it was to worship God, to who God is, what God thinks, you know, all the things he's trying to overcome inside, and son, hopefully you're not listening. And then eventually being able to like worship on your own.
Right.
But that's the progression all of us have. Yeah. Like there's this, I've got to actually believe it before I actually express it. Like it's got to actually get in me before it gets out of me. And so, I mean, I used to coach tennis and it would take 6 to 12 months before a kid would start to ask questions about what I'm, you know, spending hours with them a week trying to show them stuff. But then once they ask the question, it's in them. And now they're processing it to where it finally gets out.
Right.
And their parents, you know, first couple months, hey, why is my kid not this, not that? And I said, just wait. I said, it's probably going to be a couple more months. But then when they ask this question, it's going to just pop and they're going to go. Mm. And the same thing happens in worship. Like, I love what Bethany's saying. Like, there's a progression, but there's also a season of like permission. I think that's kind of something that we really fight for, is giving the band permission. I remember when we first visited Providence, we tried to take the band somewhere they hadn't been before. And there was so much frustration, but we just stopped. And I just said, let's just practice. Let's just play. We're the only ones in the room. We're not playing for tomorrow. We're playing for right now. And so I just started playing acoustic and slowly the band came together. But all of a sudden, everybody was just like, what was that? That was awesome. It's like, that was just us worshiping. We know the music. We know what we're trying to get, but we have to get there. And when we get there, the room can get there.
Yeah.
You know, and so like really giving people applicable, tangible handles onto, okay, how do we step into this? You know, giving people permission to have their, even if it's a quiet guy, have his chance to think about it, process it, and then release it.
Yeah, so good. That's great. Did you guys, were you both at Firestorm this past week?
Yes.
What'd you guys think of it?
Oh my gosh, it was absolutely incredible.
It was pretty cool.
Yeah.
My, one of my, like, because we're talking about worship, Nathan's first session called Yod with Kabod.
I missed it. I'm so sorry.
You gotta look at that one.
We'll watch it.
It is so good because he talks about like what Yod means and like lifting hands and Kabod, you know, being weight, but also an expression of something God's giving you that you give back to Him. But it was like mind blowing,
and for
worship leaders or for people who love to worship, actually for anyone, it was just really effective. Really, it actually challenged me.
That's awesome. I was
really challenged by it.
That's amazing.
No, yeah, Firestorm from like the first night, from the first note, from the first person, actually you know, Charles and Ann getting up and talking, just all of it, it just blew up. Mm-hmm. And it's like we didn't stop the whole weekend either.
And at one point we were back recording a future song that we're working on. And Nathan comes back and is like, you guys, he just preached on Let the Lion Roar, and y'all are working on that song.
What?
That's the title of our song.
No way.
While he was preaching that message.
We got to go back and listen to that.
Yeah.
That's amazing. Yes. And actually, it was like a couple people kept harping on this roar thing.
Right.
Yeah.
So it's like, and that's what I love about the Lord is that we, you know, it's the same spirit.
Yes.
We're all listening to the same spirit. Like, you know, there'll be a movement of God that'll be like, you know, the Father's love is like just going throughout
over
the church.
Over and over again. Right.
You know, it's like, this is a theme that it's not one person got it and everyone duplicated that one person. Is it the Holy Spirit sending this message?
Right.
Hey, let me re-educate the yes. church on the Father's love. And everyone's right. like, oh, this is a thing we need to get.
And it's hitting right. denominations. It's hitting different states. It's yep. hitting different like sizes of churches. Mm-hmm. And it's just, it's getting out.
Right.
Yeah. So, yeah.
That's so good.
I mean, even Sean Bowles put a blurb out on Facebook the other day that was like, he's going to give you a roar louder than the sound around you or something. Mm-hmm. And it's all like, man, we've been writing this song for a couple weeks. Wow. It's like God has been just downloading roar, lions, yeah. all this stuff. And I'm like, you know, I just want to scream sometimes, but I won't do it right now. So I got to save it. Got to save it.
For the album.
For the album.
Just you scream. I know. Is it a screamo worship song?
It should be. We are joking. Maybe we'll get our kids. We should definitely get our kids in there because they love going roar. Yeah. And like just getting them, having that in the background.
Yeah. Awesome. My kids love roaring too. I don't know why. It's like, and what's a lion say? Roar. And then, yeah. Just.
That's how I get them to brush their teeth. What's a lion say? Roar. And then I'm in there.
Yeah, real quick. Yeah.
I know.
Yeah, that's so good.
No, yeah. Firestorm was lit though. It was really good.
Yeah. I was just so impressed what God was doing. And there was this moment. Sorry, guys, who didn't go to Firestorm. You can go to firestorm2021.com, download the sessions for a nominal fee. And watch all of them, and
totally worth
and
it.
they would be yours forever. There was this one moment, Sammy Rodriguez. I don't know if you guys missed his morning session or not.
Well, we were recording when that happened.
Oh, okay,
yeah.
Because then Bishop, after his session, did a lion roar one, and he showed a video clip.
Lord. Oh my goodness!
You didn't know this, like about your roar, not a lion roar, just about wow. your roar.
Yeah,
and it's about
That's
and so
insane.
you got to look it up. But anyway,
definitely wow. will.
So Sammy, his whole testimony, Sammy Rodriguez, his whole testimony starts when he was a 14-year-old boy sitting in the sanctuary and Teen Challenge. Do you
yeah.
know Teen Challenge?
Mm-hmm.
They used to have like, and I think they still do, they have choirs that they get the men together and they build a choir and then travel church to church and it raises yeah. money for the organization. And the choir director of Teen Challenge was at this AG church in Allentown, Pennsylvania.
Mm-hmm.
And the choir director stops and turns around and says, it stops everything. It was in the middle of a song, says, there's a young man in here. His name is Samuel. No, Sammy.
Wow.
And where is he? And everyone points to Sammy Rodriguez. And he goes, you're going to be advising and speaking to presidents. And God's wow. going to use you in this. And his wife, who wasn't his wife yet because there was only 14 years old, was in the room. Her name is Eva. And they end up getting married. And he always says, you know, if a woman knows your prophetic word on your life, you know, she was smart. She was like, let me marry
she's
him.
She's going to lock in.
So she locked him in. So years later, she locks him in. But anyway, so this testimony, he's, you know, he's been in Time Magazine, Christianity Today, Charisma, you know, all that. And he's always told this story, you know, Sammy Rodriguez, 14-year-old boy, prophesied, da, da, da.
Right.
But he didn't know that guy. He was 14 years old, right?
Wow.
So the next morning in Firestorm, the man stops him in the lobby. The man was here.
No.
The choir director. He's like 70 years old now.
Oh,
are you kidding me?
Not goodness. Kidding, because Roarsburg,
right.
Teen Challenge is like Whoa. 40 minutes away. And he's like, Sammy, I was the choir director at Teen Challenge. And Sammy's like mind's blown.
Right.
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 He calls the guy up for his morning session and just says, I want you to, and he goes, my wife and I have talked about you. Like, I wonder if he's still alive. I wonder who he is.
What he's doing, right?
Yeah. Yeah. And the choir director said, well, Sammy, I want you to know that I didn't know who you'd become, but that was such a strong word that I had given. I wrote your name down on a paper that's framed on my desk, and my wife and I would pray for the Sammy who's going to be speaking to presidents one day.
Oh my goodness.
And so, you know, it wasn't like a random word. Like he's like,
wow.
You know, it wasn't like he was like going, oh, I'm going to give a prophetic word to every church
right.
I go to. It
right,
was like this
right,
one
right.
word he got and right. that he prayed over this unknown Sammy.
Oh,
and I mean,
my
and
goodness.
Think about what would have happened had he not done that.
Right.
I mean, maybe he may, and
maybe
God,
it all happened.
God's sovereignty
but,
still, you know, yeah. takes, but like, when you put the goal in front of you, all of a sudden we start to work towards that goal. Yep. And I almost feel like that was God's way of getting Sammy to look that way.
Yeah.
And to like kind of keep his eyes fixed and get in. And I mean, like I love that. Like just the sensitivity of that man to do that. And then yeah. for it all to line up at Firestorm 2021, yeah. like that's insane.
Yeah. It was so cool.
Yeah.
And so, you know, you're like, well, these, so much happens at the conferences at Life Center. Of course, they happen all over the world, conferences, but I just, you know, just seeing God's hand in a lot of it. It's like, not only did Sammy bless us with the word of the Lord for that night and the next morning, but, you know, God is like God's kiss back to him. Like, hey, here's the guy. And it was just beautiful. And like, if anything doesn't happen the rest of the week,
we're good.
I'm good. Like that, that was good. Yeah. But let's wrap it up, guys.
Lunch?
Yeah. Close the doors. Everyone's going out.
Right.
So it was good. But it just kept getting better because then Nathan spoke. Charles Stock kicked it out of the park. I mean, it was such a great message. And then Steph Gretzinger spoke. And it was just this holiness, this call to, you know, going to Jesus. And basically, she didn't have a title for a message, but if I were to title it, it would be called Jesus is the Well and the Water.
Oh, come on. That's
and that's what she would talk about. That's so good. It's just so good.
So many people are impacted, like, because we kind of had to sprinkle in and out just based on our schedules, but like so many people from our church were coming like that as well. And each one of them, oh my gosh, this person. And it was like they came to the exact message they had to hear.
Yeah.
And it was just, it was lights out all weekend.
Yeah. And the Holy Spirit does these things that, you know, I always want to be open to what the Holy Spirit does. And this is something that is this like tension, I think, that we walk out as Christians, because I'm like, there's things that I plan, that I try to plan with my ear to God.
Yeah, that's good.
And then there's things that happen that I realize is God and I need to let happen, you know, that might usurp the plan that, that I have for my day, my life, whatever it might be, the conference.
Yeah, because we plan it, he establishes it. And it's like his established, like the way he establishes is not always the way I see it or feel it. Even though that might have leaned me in the right direction, I still needed a little bump still. And so, yeah, just trusting it, not just in the planning, but also in the execution. He's right there with me.
Yeah.
So good.
Yeah. It's awesome.
Mm-hmm.
And that's some of the leadership here, you know, they, that's, I think, one of the greatest things that they do is that they're sensitive to what God's doing. So they do plan and have a game plan.
Right.
Even if it's for the wrong reason, they end up getting to the right place because they're they're sensitive to what God's doing. And Ann Stock says it very beautifully. She says something to the extent of like, we might have gotten there for the wrong reason, but we got there. Wait, we got to the right place, maybe for the wrong reason. Like we thought we were doing it for this reason, but we actually got where God really wanted us to be. And we wouldn't have gotten there maybe if we didn't do it the way we did. I don't know.
Right.
So it's just, she's so much more eloquent than strict. And just really, I always say it, just real surgical when she speaks. She just knows exactly
what she had that little segment right at the beginning of Thursday night.
Yes.
And everything she said just lights out. And then she brings her family up. And just shows the generations and just says, we're not done yet. And like, I just stood up and was like, like, there's no junior Holy Spirit. There's no like cutoff.
Come on.
You know, it's like, just keep running. Like, and the fact that they're training up and just see that generational, you know, fullness. And then to see that in this church here and to see that in the region, it's beautiful.
Yeah, I totally agree. I like hate the fact that we're like, okay, mom, dad, your time's up. It's my time to shine or any that kind of thought. It's like that baton passing. There's moments where you're both running at the same time, holding the same baton.
So
and that's the moment, you know, and everyone gets to play.
Yeah.
So
I think that's a little bit of like the American ideal is when's it my turn? But then when it has to be about my turn, I'm missing out on who led me, who brought me, who launched me. And can I still be a part of that, you know? And so like, I love that she laid that out because that really showed me like, hey, who's blazing the trail for me and for Bethany and for our kids and our family? And how do we still stay on those trails that they've blazed? Even though we might take some new trails, how do we still come back to those old paths and still use what God is doing? And he's still in it for whatever the generation is.
Yeah, for sure. It's awesome. Now, speaking of generations. You guys have produced a generation, haven't you?
Yes. Well, I was actually going to mention like the correlation to what you were saying reminded me of when we first got married, we experienced 7 years of infertility. And we didn't know it at the time. We actually had someone prophesy over me in our first year of marriage. And they were like, I speak to your inner organs and I declare healing and you will have a son. And then they started prophesying over this baby. And so I was like, you know, that word was so good, but that healing of the inner organs was weird. Like I don't know about
What's
that.
What's she talking about?
Yeah, I was like, I don't
good.
Think there's anything wrong there, but
I think I feel fine.
Organs feel great. And 4 years later, we discover that we were infertile. And there was a whole process with that, but it was so cool because she prophesied something before I ever knew there was a problem. She was already declaring the healing over it. And so then I looked back and was like, whoa, she knew exactly what she was talking about. And then we have this idea, we had gotten prophesied that we were going to have twins. And so I totally thought, you know, twins run in his family, like that's totally a possibility. The next thing you know, we get a call from his cousin, and she, long story short, says, I feel like God's telling me that you're supposed to adopt my child. And she's pregnant.
What?
Finds out she's pregnant after she has that thought, like goes and finds out, oh, I actually am pregnant. Like it wasn't just like something I saw. It's this is what it is.
And so I was like, wow, okay. Like I'm going to have to hear that for myself too.
Right.
That's Let me
good,
talk to God.
That's actually a good word.
Like,
Let me
check
talk
prophecies.
To him.
Like check check what you're hearing from people, because God might be like, hey, that's wonderful that they thought that was me, but
that was a prophetic opinion.
Right. Yes. An opinion. That's exactly right.
So I end up, you know, that begins this whole process with what I thought for our lives versus what the Lord had planned.
Right.
And so we end up totally feeling God on this, and he's like, yeah, I'm calling you to adoption. And so we say yes. We go to say yes. And she ends up changing her mind. And so we're like, oh, wow.
But she changed her mind right when she found out that it was twins. Wow. So we're like, yes, it's twins. Oh, but I don't know if I can go through with it. And we were like, oh my gosh. So let me.
Yeah. So we knew the word of the Lord. And so I just released it and was like, we bless you. And just praying in time that she would change her mind. And of course she came back, changed her mind. And, there's a whole other story to that, but basically we ended up getting the twins after a crazy roller coaster ride and looking at what God had for us the whole time, looking back all the prophetic words I got about babies. I always thought one way, but the Lord fulfilled every single word. And it just didn't look like what I thought it would look like.
Right.
It actually was way better than I could have ever dreamed. Mm-hmm. It was everything that I wanted, but didn't know I needed. And so,
yeah, adoption's not for the faint of heart, because the process is grueling. But God, if God calls you in it and you say yes to it, there's grace for it.
Wow.
And so like, yeah, she changed her mind like when they were born. And so all of a sudden the heartache and all the finances we raised and all the paperwork we did. And then 7 weeks later, we got to pick them up and adopt them. But like, they're two of the sweetest kids.
Yes.
Wow. And like, we're just absolutely in love, enthralled with them. Wow. And so like, adoption is a huge, huge undertaking. But like, so many people are like, oh, well, it just doesn't feel like family or this. And it's like, no, no, no. These are our kids. Like, like we knew them while they were in the womb. Like, it's a little different for us because it's family and stuff. But like, adoption is probably one of the most beautiful correlations between us and what God has done through Christ. And so biblically it's there, but then also like to see them and to know the life that we have with them is absolutely stunning. So if there's anything anybody can do, that's thinking about adoption, I would definitely encourage you to take that step.
And it's beautiful because it relates so much to what we do. We disciple generations. Mm-hmm. And so it's such a prophetic thing that we got a boy and a girl.
Right.
Wow.
And that we've just been able to, we feel like we're fostering a generation. Like we're taking in sons and daughters who may have had a father of lies before they ever get introduced to the father of truth, and just
in love,
getting, getting that revelation just physically with our adoption, and then being able to see prophetically that that's already been happening has been so, so cool.
That is an amazing story. So, first of all, I mean, it's amazing, and God bless you guys for answering the call. Like twins are a big deal.
Huge.
I mean, my first two were twins, boy
and
a girl.
That's right. I forgot about that. That's right.
So I know what that's like. I had a full head of hair, lost it. I don't know how you kept it, but
I don't have multiple, you know, you have twins and I just had twins.
That's true.
So
that's
I'm
true.
Early
yeah.
on.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. So yeah. Good luck.
But I break that off in the
movie. Curse your word. Curse.
Yeah, curse your word.
So Okay, so that's, so she changed her mind twice, which and she's the, you know, she was the birth mom, right. So that's, you know, right. You understand yes. that she's going through this thing too with
right.
Yeah.
So she changed her mind in the beginning, then went back.
And then the and day then they were born.
The day they were born, and which is very understandable.
So understand yes. our lawyers and our, you know, all of the social workers and everybody was like, "Hey, this happens. Don't burn the bridge. Be as sweet yeah. as you possibly can. Support it because you guys are family. So don't burn yeah, the family bridges sure. either. But also don't burn the bridge in case she changes her mind."
Yeah.
And that's, I mean, yeah, it was a journey of faith. It was probably one of the darkest, probably the darkest season of our life, which ended up birthing so much beautiful music and so many beautiful moments with God that, you know, he met us in the pain. He met us in that journey. And it wasn't like he was waiting for us to get, okay, let me, you know, pull myself up and then he'll talk to me. He was like, and he just sat with us. Mm. And he sat with us in those 7 weeks and reminded us of what he had said. But
7 weeks.
Yeah, 7 weeks was how long it took for us to be able to pick him up. Yeah, because it's not just a day or two. It's not just a few weeks. Like, we went through Thanksgiving, worst Thanksgiving ever. But then we picked him up 2 days before Christmas. And so all of a sudden now it's like the best Christmas we've ever had.
Right.
We're not even thinking about presents, food, anything. We're just holding these sweet little babies, just like drooling over them. So
yeah, what's insane is like the day that she first changed her mind, I did one of those things where you just run to the Bible and flip it open and whatever's there.
Bible roulette.
Like, God, right. Beat me.
Very dangerous.
Yeah,
very dangerous, but it was amazing that day. And I remember turning to 2 Samuel, I think it was 2:10, and it was like talking about like Samuel and the anointing process, but it mentioned like, and you will receive, they will be carrying 3 loaves, but they will hand you 2 loaves. And immediately as I read that, I knew the Lord was saying, like, I'm going to give you these babies, the loaves.
Wow.
Yeah.
And then the other day, so in our hearts, we knew, like, even when she changed her mind, like, this is not over. And when we were headed to the hospital to show up for these babies, the Lord said, you're on your way to the cross. And there had been so many moments leading up that literally paralleled to his journey to the cross, like,
Crazy stuff.
And so I knew with the cross, there was going to be a resurrection.
Right.
And so we held on to that. And then years later, I'm reading the other day, and of all places, like, I think I'm reading Levitical law in Leviticus. And
which people love to do.
Light reading. Just a little.
And the other day I was reading Levitical law.
Right. It's Tuesday, you know, it's the thing to do.
Yeah. And sometimes you're just like scrolling through and you're like, all right, it's the same thing for every single thing. You're like, okay, I get it. But I came across this place where it was saying, in a certain sacrifice, you present the loaves and you have to wait 7 weeks before you present the offering.
I forgot about
that.
Wow.
And I just read that and wept and was like, oh my gosh. Wow. Because 7 years of infertility. And
7 weeks of sacrifice.
7 weeks. And then we presented the sacrifice. And it was like we handed God them and had to put them on the altar. And it was one of those moments where when she called, it was like we heard the ram's cry.
Right.
Wow. It's like, oh my gosh.
And it was crazy because like
goosebumps over here.
Oh, I know. It's like we have like story after story. But after she said no the first time, which we were like, hey, we blessed that. We blessed it the second time too. It just heartbroken. But God started talking to me after the first time and he kept saying, I've got you, I've got Bethany, I have these babies in my hands. Mm. Trust me. And like that, like I literally have that journaled. Wow. Like over and over and over and over again for months and months and months. And so like the first night we found out that she changed her mind, I'm journaling again with the Lord, just trying to go after some of those deep places. And I'm just like, I don't want to be there. And I just felt him say, write it down again. And I was like, I'm not writing that down again. Like I was so broken. I couldn't believe it. And he said, write it down again. And so I wrote it down again. You, Bethany, Zion, and Alleluia are in my hands. Trust me.
Their names?
Yeah,
Zion and Alleluia. I was going to ask that. Yeah.
And so when we finally were able to pick the babies up, he told me that a couple times over December. And when we finally get to pick the babies up, I'm holding Zion like late one night, like crying because he's crying and I can't sleep. And you know, it's like 4 o'clock in the morning and God just says, hey, remember, like you trusted me. Thank you. Wow. Like this is your reward. And it just all of a sudden, like all that brokenness just like turned into praise. And I just began to worship. And I'm holding my son. You know, my daughter's asleep. Bethany's passed out on the couch somewhere. And, you know, we're at my parents' house. But I'm just worshiping God, just like absolutely just enthralled with the fact that, like, he prepared me for 9 months practically. Like preparing me for the fact that we would lose them, but then that we would gain them as well. So it's it was insane season.
Yeah. What an incredible story.
Yeah,
it is.
And you're still living that out. How's the, you know, if you don't mind me asking, how's the relationship with your sister? Are you guys still in process?
Oh, with my cousin.
Oh, it's your cousin.
Yeah.
It's your cousin?
My cousin,
Oh, I thought it was your sister.
No.
Okay.
Yeah, my cousin. So we haven't seen her in a while, but we still text her. We just texted her the other day. She got a new phone number, and we were like, oh, okay. And then, but we send her pictures, and we try to, you know, constantly bless her on like some key dates and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. Cause we're just so thankful, but we haven't had a chance to like sit with her cause COVID and kids and all the things. Yeah, so
but the relationship has been amazing just to have, we have an open adoption, which means that, you know, we can let her see them as much as we want or as little. And the Lord's just been so good between the dynamics of that. He's been so faithful, and she sees it as such a blessing. Like every time she hears, you know, anything that God's doing and sees them, she's just so grateful, and we're grateful back. So it's
we know
been
it's heavy
honor.
For her too. Like,
yeah.
I mean, I can't imagine to, for me on this side of it, which I can't do legally because you can't give up kids that you've adopted. Like it's like the judge actually says, and you cannot unadopt. It's actually illegal, you know,
really?
to unadopt.
I had no idea. I mean, I've never been in the.
Right. It's, but that whole process is beautiful too. But like,
but can you unadopt your kids though? Like, you're—I mean, these are your kids,
right?
But they're your son, your daughter,
right?
So I don't want to say it that way, but I'm just saying, like, So I guess the birth parents, can they ever put, like, is that like open?
You can just
put your kids for adoption. Like, my kids are 16. I'm like, I'm tired of this. Can you put them up for adoption?
I don't know if you can put them up for adoption. I know people abandon their kids at all different ages and stuff like that. You know, and then they end up in the foster. They end up in the system because there's no one to take them, or family member or somebody.
I'm not saying it because I think it's funny or think people should do it. I'm just like, is that even a thing?
If your kids are listening, they're probably a little worried at this point. But you know, like,
you guys should worry. No, just kidding.
A little fear goes a long way. A little fear.
Actually, Christy Bray was just preaching on this, and he said that when you have an inheritance as a father, if you adopt a son, then they automatically have to receive the inheritance. But if it's your son that you birthed, you can actually choose not to give them your inheritance.
Right.
Wow.
And
we're adopted, we can't not inherit.
Right.
What is God's? Yeah.
Wow, that's powerful.
Isn't that?
You get into adoption, all of a sudden, all this stuff just starts like
unlocking and connecting. Yeah.
I know. Wow.
I remember having a conversation with Melissa Helser about this whole thing. It was before we even had adoption on the table, but people were coming to me and saying like, "Oh, are you guys going to adopt because you're infertile?" Mm. It was like, what?
Right.
We're not just throwing a Band-Aid on this thing just because we feel, you know, a lack in one area. We were really waiting for the Lord. And I remember telling her, like, I just feel like adoption is a calling. Like, you got to be called to it. She looked at me. She's like, can I be real with you? I was like, you know it. And she said, calling is religious BS. And I was like, okay, here we go.
Bethany's Southern Baptist roots just kind of shriveled. And she was like, oh my gosh, Melissa. Like,
oh snap, I'm attentive. And she was like, you know, we use that as a way to not do what the Lord has asked us to consider. She's like, you know, people don't want to go to Africa. So they're like, I'm not called to Africa. When really, he's just asking you to consider it. Mm-hmm. And
that's what
I remember
up when my cousin called, will you consider it?
Walking away from that conversation, just like, oh my gosh, I got to consider it. And you know those things where you don't bring it up to the Lord because you're afraid he might say yes? And so you're like, I'm just not going to bring up this adoption thing.
We're not going to talk about
it.
Hey, what about that thing over there? And I'm like, no, what?
God hasn't told me that. It's like, have you asked him? Well, no.
Let me sing you another song. Jesus, we love you.
Let's just
do something else.
I need the Holy Spirit to fall so that they fall and I can leave and we can stop this conversation.
So I remember that, like, when we got the call, which was absolutely insane, I was like, wow. And I kind of put it on the back burner, and then I was taking a nap and I literally got audibly woken up by the voice of the Lord, and he said, but have you considered it? Sure. And I was like, okay, this means like I actually have to bring it to the table. And so we did. And when I did, he absolutely said yes.
And so thankful that we did, because again, adoption has been one of the most beautiful stories of love, like to choose a child. I mean, I know that you love your kids despite all the things you've said, but but like, it's one thing, like, and you're still choosing your child because you get married, you know, you go through the whole process of all those things, but like to say, we're going to say yes to this. And the journey of that yes, like it starts the second you say yes, it's a yes forever. And so like, we've had nothing but yeses over our kids, and yes, they cry and they poop and they scream and fling the poop and all the things. But like to know that we could love as deeply as we are right now with our kids, and for it to be a story of adoption, I just say, like, whatever myth you've heard, it's not real. You know, adoption is just as beautiful as coming home from the hospital. It's just, it's, do you have a yes for it?
Yeah.
Wow. So good.
So good.
Yeah. And we had, Sam, what's their, Lindy and Chase on, and they're big into adoption.
Yes.
And I love that, you know, I forget who said it. I don't know if it was Andy Bird or, but that if we want to see the stronghold of abortion broken in this country, we need to get into adoption. You know, the church needs to be active in adoption.
Yes.
And, you know, the reality is that church, people like try to glaze over Christianity in the world, especially in the Western society and America. But the reality is that there's Christian hospitals all over the world for a reason.
Right.
There's, you know, adoption agencies and taking care of the orphan and the needy and the sick and the widowed was a call from Jesus.
That's right.
And so this is what church is about. You know, it's not just about a corporate gathering, which we love doing, but as a big corporate church, the church, Big C, worldwide, we need to adopt. And I don't know if you guys know Mike and Dina Van Hall. They were missionaries in China, and they basically had one of the only orphanages that held, if not the orphanage, only orphanage that took in babies that were abandoned, which were often disabled children.
Was that one of those Finger of God, Holy Spirit?
Yeah, yeah. Yes. So I've known them. They're Global Awakening.
No way.
Yeah, yeah. They're great people.
That's amazing. And, that story. I cried every time.
The whole time.
Oh
man.
I think that's Father of Lights.
Yeah, they're like, you know, there's like a few people you spend time with. You're like, wow, I can just. They feel like really full of Jesus, you know?
Right.
So it's like Heidi Baker. I'm like, don't look at me. You know, like I look into her eyes.
I don't even love Jesus.
She's like, yes, Paul. You're like, who are you?
Mother me.
I had lunch with her once the first time I had lunch with her, I was like, I'm just not going to talk.
Right.
Not gonna talk.
Just please give me everything.
Mike and Dina are the same.
Yeah.
You know, Dan Moeller. I don't know if you know Dan Moeller.
Yes.
Dude,
yes.
That guy.
I'm like,
what a father.
Yeah. I have my master's and you've been through seminary, and I'm like, I'm not going to say anything.
You shredded everything.
In my mind, I'm like, don't say anything stupid. Don't say anything stupid.
Right.
Yes.
But yeah, they're just full of love. So, you know, this whole adoption thing, Dina said in her, one of her conferences she came to at Global, she said that I think it was like if 6% of the church would adopt, and I think it was like one couple in every church in America, there'd be no orphans.
Yeah.
Wow.
Something crazy. Like that.
I guess it'd be every year.
Right.
But, you know, that's just mind blowing.
Right.
You know, it's not like a big
right
thing that we can't do.
Right.
And what's crazy too, is that when we had just said, you know, we'll pray about it and we'll ask the Lord, like if this is something that he wants for us. I was, you know, talking to his mom, and I was like, you know, you don't think she would ever go to the abortion clinic, right? She was like, no. Well, literally that afternoon, that's where she went. And she goes in, and there's only one woman working. And the woman like drops something, cusses, goes, oh, I shouldn't cuss, I'm a Christian. And she goes, my gosh, what is this, like undercover Jesus in an abortion clinic?
Right.
And she goes back there, and the woman asks her like, hey, I'm not supposed to do this, but do you want to see the screen? And she was like, no. She asked her three times. And the third time she goes, okay, show me. And she goes, you're having twins. And she said, she just starts bawling because on the way there, she told the Lord, you're going to have to give me a sign. If you want me to keep this baby, you're going to have to let it be twins.
She said, I'm going to cut you off for a while, but you have one chance. Like, yeah, like if this is twins, I'll reconsider. But if it's not, done.
Wow.
And so like,
so yeah,
even that prayer, whether that's the Holy Spirit impressing upon her or whatever God does and whatever she was going through, like she shared that story and was like, man, like to know that God was there, she goes, it was immediately done. I was done. Wow. Then the woman says
like, so I'm going to have to schedule this procedure for Friday since it's double.
But
you do not have to come back in.
Points right at her. You don't have to come back. And so Lauren's like, I'm not coming back.
I love
you know?
This.
Like, I know. Yeah. So like, I'm.
We always joke.
Oh man, I hope that lady.
Right.
Is
right?
Just, I mean, I hope, you know, hopefully she's just there to be
bless.
Undercover.
Yes. I hope so.
And being like, you know what? I'm going to make a difference.
Right.
I'm going to go and.
Right.
We
it's
joke
either
that
yeah. or like they all closed up for lunch and then an angel comes in, opens right. up the door. It's just like, ooh, I cussed. Ooh, sorry.
Right,
and then,
right.
You know, like just goes through the whole, I don't right. care if it's an angel, yeah. if it's a woman, if you're listening, thank you.
God bless
you know, like
yes.
God bless you. But that was the story of these kids was that like, even for my cousin, like she was like, man, like God has something. On their lives and like we can't ignore it. And so like, you know, what started out as a really dark story ended up being the most marvelous story of like redemption for her, for these kids, for what God's doing in our lives. And, you know, it's, we all get there. We all get to that panic place of like, oh my gosh, like, can I, oh, I don't know. Like, and we fill our minds with 1,000 thoughts, but like God is so faithful and God's in it.
Yeah. It's so good. It reminds me of a Bill Johnson quote, where Bill says, what qualifies you is not what you're qualified to do, but if you're willing to do it.
Right.
Mm. You know, mm-hmm. if you're yes, if you'll consider it.
Right.
You know, basically.
I love it.
And yeah.
Yeah.
And so anyway, there's an amazing story that goes along with that with my wife and
so good.
Bill. My wife, when she married me, she just felt unqualified for, you know, ministry, all this other stuff. And she's an oncologist by trade. And so she's standing next to me. We're only engaged. We're in Australia. And she's like, I shouldn't even be on this front row because she was with me. So she was in the front row. She wanted to pay to come to the conference.
Mm.
You know, like, even though I was running it, you know,
like,
she's like, no, I need to pay to be here. You know, that she had that spirit.
Yeah,
she's doing it. And so ministry's going on. I'm praying for people. And she's like weeping at the front row, standing there going like, just feeling like, so unqualified.
Right.
She feels this arm come around her and said, it's the anointing that qualifies you. You're qualified by the anointing. He just keeps praying this prayer and it's Bill.
Wow.
It's Bill Johnson.
Wow.
Is that amazing? So,
oh my God.
Isn't that
God.
So cool? Such
never,
a great story.
I'm never washing this shirt again.
Yeah, I know. I'd be like, Bill never prays for me.
Right.
Like, wait.
Oh my
I'm
gosh.
Like, babe, that's a pretty amazing, you know, but the whole thing is that, you know, sometimes we always like, well, God, if I can do this or if I'm prepared for this or, and it's just really kept us and God's really just saying like, you know, let me worry about that stuff. I just want to know if you'll do it.
Right.
You
yes.
know? Right.
And that's where I was. Like 7 years of infertility really gets deep down in your core, whether you acknowledge it or not. I was at a point where I was like, whatever you want, Lord. Like, I'm okay with, you know, not having kids in this season. Like, I'm actually really enjoying the flexibility that we have to just be a mother to, you know, people that weren't our children. And I got to this place where it was like, I don't feel worthy. Like I, when I finally took it to the Lord, we got down to like why I didn't feel called. And it was the fact that I felt unworthy and I actually bought into the lie that because we were infertile, that God didn't want me to be a mother. Mm. And so I didn't want to Hagar the situation by saying like, oh, nope, I want a baby. So let's make it happen and do this. And so I even spiritualized it. And the Lord's like, I am not using you. He said, the birth mother is not using you. I am choosing you.
Wow.
And I got wrecked and it was insane. And that's right when I said my yes to the Lord, I got done journaling and I was like, I say yes. And I go to tell Caleb, and that's when he had just got off the phone and she had told him that she went to the abortion clinic.
Whoa.
And I lost it because for the second he told me, I thought, oh my gosh, I just went to say yes. And she just killed the very thing that I just said yes to. Like, I cried for 10 minutes, even though he said she didn't do it. But I cried. Yeah.
She, like, I've never seen her cry. Right.
Like a deep,
like guttural. Yeah. Like, I was like, what is happening? Because, like, up until then, I didn't think she was in. Like, I thought I was praying about it. I thought she was like,
and I didn't think I was in.
Right.
And so, after that, I felt, as I was crying, like the mother in me had awoken.
That's exactly what was crying.
I was thinking the same
and it was
thing.
Like exactly Deborah, when she like awakens as a mother to Israel, it was like undeniable to him, Bethany. And undeniable to me.
Wow. You guys should write a book about this.
I'm actually in the process of doing that.
You should, really. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's just so many people who would get blessed by this story.
Yeah.
And I hope people listening really hear the Lord about this stuff. So it's awesome. I'm sure they're being really encouraged.
Yeah.
Hey, I don't want to cut us too short, but I do want to talk about lukewarm lies. This is not you.
That is me. That's
this is CJ
Kuenzli.
Kuenzli.
Yeah.
Kuenzli. You might need an author name. You might need to like change that to like
something
Kuenzli or something.
Yeah, something easy to say.
Yeah, like have those pen
That's
names.
That's smart.
I know. I thought about using the CJ, Caleb Joshua. I thought about just using that. But then I've got this book, a number of other Christian ones, and I've also got some novels I'm working on.
No way.
And I was like, ooh, C.S. Lewis. I'm not like him, but you know, I'll steal it. That's a good idea.
C.J. Lewis.
Yeah, C.J. Lewis. There
is that
it
what you're saying?
That's what I'm saying.
And
I'm
everyone's just, like, this must be his grandson,
right?
Yeah. And then you're like,
off the just Amazon everyone's number just, one seller.
Yeah,
right?
People are like, the reviews are like, bought
hilarious.
This book thinking it was C.S. Lewis' grandson.
It wasn't.
It wasn't.
He's a liar. Yeah. Right. And then I get
that's
canceled.
A lukewarm lie.
I get canceled immediately.
Yeah.
No, but I wanted something that. I don't know. It just felt better to put CJ there, and it felt
it's awesome.
Proper.
No, I'm just messing with you. Anyway, it's called Lukewarm Lies. CJ Kuenzli, Kuenzli.
You had to look at that and, three times.
I'm just surprised. I'm surprised. What is that? Is that German?
Yeah, it's like a Swiss German name.
Yeah,
so we actually there's a Kuenzli construction up here somewhere and
spelled
differently, but that's just back in the Dutch
because they changed
world.
It. They were like, what are we doing?
I know.
We used to have
there was the umlaut over the U for a while. And
really?
I think my grandparents like took it off.
That.
Yeah. Like we don't need to get beat up anymore for our last name.
So. No, I'm just messing with you. Yeah. Anyway, it's called, this book here is called Lukewarm Lies, Discovering Half Truths of the 21st Century Church.
Mm-hmm.
And it's 9 truths.
10.
10.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. I was going to say 9 would have been an odd number. I thought you said 9.
But. Yeah, no, 10. 10.
10 truths of lies? 10 truths?
Well, look
at what is this book about?
What's this book about?
Really? I haven't read it, but he's authored it. So.
Right, which I appreciate the shout out when you haven't read it. No, just really looking at a lot of the things that we as the church, like little phrases, like the whole reason it's called lukewarm lies, hot versus cold. Otherwise, if you're lukewarm, I'll spit you out of my mouth. Like, what does that really mean? Mm. And it's not Jesus versus Satan and don't be stuck in the middle, you know, to either go to heaven or go to hell. It's be useful or be useful. And if you've lost your usefulness, I'll spit you out of my mouth. And so like, stay fresh, stay connected to the source. And so that thought hit me and I just went, oh my gosh, like how many other little isms do we have that somebody said, and it was good, but it became our theology.
Yeah.
You know, like Paul didn't say, we're sinners saved by grace. He said, I'm a sinner, or I was a sinner and the chiefest of sinners. And then then later he said, I'm saved by grace.
Right.
But we created this ism that's, oh, well, we're just sinners saved by grace, friend. And that's all there is to it. And it's like, no, that's not biblical.
Yeah.
And so dismantling some of those things and trying to make it accessible, trying to make it easy and palatable, trying to, you know, create a little mystery with the title and
I love it.
See what happens.
So good.
Yeah.
Well, I appreciate it. And hopefully it blesses a lot of people.
Yeah. Thanks, man.
So, and Sam left us a little gift.
Look at that.
A gift for you guys. I guess since we're coming up on Easter.
Yes.
Oh,
do you guys love peeps?
I do.
Do you really?
I do until you eat a few and then you go.
And then you're like, do you want to try some? These are special.
Are they
look
special
at that.
Peeps?
Yeah. They're gluten and fat free.
Okay.
Apparently on this.
I would love to, but I can't right now. I'm trying to be healthy.
Are you lenting?
No.
We are lenting.
I'm not lenting, but just trying
you're
to
lamenting.
Be healthy. Yeah. But you can have some, please.
No, actually, I'm not eating sugar.
Oh, okay. Right now. Yeah, I'm
that's
not
where
doing,
we're at.
That's
too.
Where we're at.
Oh, really? Right. No
okay.
sugars.
We'll keep the peeps.
Thank you, Lord. And, thank you for these peeps, Jesus.
Thank you. So we tried.
We tried.
We could have broken. I love how packaging says like gluten free, fat free.
It's
like
got to.
I mean, eating that. That's worried about that.
I know. Right? I know. Or sometimes it's like. Sometimes it'll be like something that's super obvious, but they know it's trendy to put it on there. It'll be like milk, gluten free.
Like,
right.
Thanks
right?
for that.
It's like. Like,
I didn't know.
Like, no wheat is in this milk.
I didn't realize the cows weren't made of
yeah.
wheat.
Yeah. It's like, you're like, that's oh, hilarious. That's amazing.
Right.
Gluten-free milk. Who would have thought? But there's always these things of like,
oh but
it's, of
but,
course it's gluten-free. It's always
right,
been gluten-free.
Right. Yep. I know. Now, now we have human milk. You know, we had to go to almond milk, silk milk, and then we came back around to like, you know, cow milk, I guess.
Yeah.
Human milk, I think that should be the next seller.
Is that weird? Oh, man. That's like a thing.
Is it really?
I bet
yes.
It is.
Yeah, yeah.
I bet
it is a thing. People order it.
That's
oh man,
online.
What a latte.
Bodybuilders drinking. Yeah. I mean, my friends would tell them, just stop this. Is that what you're saying? Don't talk about this.
Anyway, we should go back to cow milk.
Yeah,
cow milk is delicious.
Yeah.
It's nutritious. We should
right.
do it.
And whole. I'm like into whole milk.
Whole milk's delicious.
Yeah.
It's creamy.
Mm. Totally.
I grew up on skim milk. Like I had whole milk for the first time when we got married and I was like,
what is this?
Yeah. Like my parents thought they were doing me a favor giving me skim milk.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
But and really, it was just watered down milk.
That's
I was like, you can make skim milk. Just buy a gallon of whole, and then like,
and then half,
half everything. Here's a little milk. Here's some water, and that's cereal.
That's right.
Skim.
Ron Swanson's like, I hate skim milk. It's water pretending to be milk or something like that. Yeah.
I love soy milk. Have you ever heard about soy milk? And it's usually almond milk,
right?
But someone said soy milk. Is it just a Spanish milk saying, "I am milk"? Because soy in Spanish is I am, so it's like soy milk.
I am milk.
It's got like subliminal messages.
It does. It draws you in.
Of course, it's milk.
Right.
Well, hey, guys, it's already been an hour.
Dang.
Incredible time passed by, but it's been so much fun. Thank you so much for being a part of this podcast and stopping by. I know you guys are in Providence Church right now. Mm-hmm. We should have gave a shout out to them earlier, they'll forgive us. And I'm so glad you guys are living in the area, and I hope many people are blessed by this. But usually our guests pray for the audience. So
sweet.
If you guys don't mind just praying and...
Yeah.
Whoever wants to do it, whenever.
I'll go.
Just do it.
Well, Father, I just thank you so much for every listener that's tuned in today. God, I thank you for everything that was brought up and what you're stirring in the hearts of people here, God. I ask that you would just lay a mantle upon the listeners of a ready spirit to say yes to all of those things that have been on the back burner that they don't want to bring to you because it's so risky. But I just ask that risk would be involved today in every single conversation that people have with you, that they would bring it to you so that you can call out things that they never thought were possible, things that they maybe didn't want to say yes to before, but giving them a fire for the things of your heart and meeting them in the dreams that they have had but didn't know would look a different way. And so I bless everyone that feels the stirring of adoption in their heart to rise up and take over every orphan, that there would be no more orphans in the land because of what you're doing, God. And we thank you that you've adopted us. We thank you that you have given us an inheritance that we had no idea how good it was. And so, Father, bring people into families and create new families because of this. And we ask that you would just do a new thing in this land. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Do you guys have a website?
We do. It's rekindleretreats.org. I was actually going to say something about that. We've got a ministry called Land of the Living, and we actually have an adult retreat coming up May...
19th through the 22nd.
It's like a four-day intensive of really just getting into God's identity and my identity, and really like learning how to dismantle a lot of the lies that keep us from Him, and then really giving Him permission to meet us every day in every way that he possibly can.
Come on.
Yeah, rekindleretreats.org, and then you can kind of
Say that again. Say it really fast.
Rekindleretreats.org.
Okay, awesome.
Yep.
And you guys lead, you know, you have worship music, mm-hmm. and do you guys have a YouTube channel anyone can check out? Because we're basically on...
Caleb and Bethany Kuenzli right there.
Caleb and Bethany Kuenzli. just go on YouTube, search for that, and they have one playlist and a ton of other videos. They don't do playlists.
Well, yeah, we need to do some playlists.
They do have a lot of videos on there.
We got our album on there, and we're actually in the process of recording a new one. So
this is you and Bethany leading worship right here.
Yeah,
this is actually just me. I think you weren't on that Sunday.
I wasn't. I was in the crowd getting it.
Yep.
King of my heart.
Mm-hmm.
It's a great. Such a good voice.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
She slaps.
This is this past week.
Look at that.
March 3rd. Come on. All right. Well, thank you guys so much
for
being
for
a part
us.
Of us and doing this with us. Has been a lot of fun.
Yeah, man.
You guys are great people.
Much.
Thanks, man.
And I just want to let you guys know, thank you so much for listening. I hope this blessed you. I hope it drew you to Jesus and stirred your heart for more things of God and being willing to consider everything he brings in front of you. We had a great time for Firestorm. It was a great God conference, God ordained God moments throughout it. I want to also let you know there is a worship summit coming up. If you go to lifecenterworship.com, is it lifecenterworship.com? Get that right website. It'll be on the screen. But there's a worship summit coming, and it's got amazing speakers lined up, ministers, and it's going to be in the fall of 2021. So make sure you get on there, register now, because the cheapest rates are right now for that conference. And until then, thanks so much for checking in. We love you. We'll see you again. Peace. That's a wrap.